Gathered here today to commemorate James E. Miller, Jr., husband, father, and grandfather. He was born in 1920 in Bartlesville, Oklahoma. He married Barbara Anderson in Washington, D.C. in 1944. They had two children, myself and Charlotte, and stayed together until Barbara died in 1981. Dad then found the second love of his life, Kathleen Farley, whom he married in 1990. He died at home in Chicago 1 year ago today on his 90th birthday. Unlike his own father, a roustabout who was a man of few words, my dad was neither a simple nor a quiet man. He never forgot his humble origins, but he was a cosmopolitan scholar, well-trained and well-traveled. Resolute, painstaking, and full of ambition, he was a man of the world. He was also always a man of the word, a lifelong student of literature, in love with language, a love he conveyed generously to almost anyone who crossed his path, from family and friends to the countless students he mentored during his career as a teacher. I remember him being happiest when he was working with words, crafting a fresh interpretation of a classic American text, toiling on a textbook, preparing a speech to deliver at one of the innumerable professional conferences he took pleasure in attending. Happy, too, he was when he felt himself immersed in helping to build some sturdier vessel of public instruction, be it a better Department of English at the University of Nebraska, or a more effective National Council of the Teachers of English for the Teachers of the United States, or simply a better way to tell a better story about the literary history of America. Dad loved America. This land was his land, and he wanted to give back to it. He was a small D Democrat who never forgot the common man. He savored the union songs of the Almanac Singers, and he loved to tell the story of how he had helped his dad, who worked in the oil fields for Frank Phillips, to drive a union truck with loudspeakers and to pass out leaflets to other workers, urging them to join the union. That labor union, I learned years later, had been a front for the local Communist Party, and Grandpa had been their unwitting accomplice. As punishment for his activism, Phillips had banished Grandpa from Tulsa to remote rural Oklahoma. The perfidy of the Soviets after the war completed the political transformation of the older Miller men, and Dad became a lifelong Democrat and a visceral anti-communist, a conviction that divided us in the 60s when I became an anti-war activist and born-again socialist, while Dad tenaciously kept faith with the Cold War liberalism of Johnson and Humphrey. Dad could be vehement, but he was never intolerant. He liked to argue, to push, and to probe with words. He enjoyed the back and forth, the banter about politics, about literature, and about the changing politics of literature departments. In his first book, he characteristically praised the work of F. Scott Fitzgerald for what Edmund Wilson had called its gesture of indefinite revolt, an inchoate mood of restlessness and rebellion that Dad prized highly. Elsewhere, he also quoted with approval the advice that Henry James had once given to young writers. Quote, "Oh, do something from your point of view. Do something with life. Any point of view is interesting that is a direct impression of life. You each have an impression colored by your individual conditions. Make that into a picture framed by your own personal wisdom, your glimpse of the American world." And when Dad in 1977 published what to me is his most courageous book, T.S. Eliot's Personal Wasteland, he really did do something with life. And in doing so, he made his own gesture of indefinite revolt against the pieties of the New Criticism and the Chicago School that had been his starting point. If I recall such highlights of my dad's public career, it is because I knew him not just as a father, but as a fellow academic, for I became a teacher, and I am very much this teacher's son. Still, my most primordial memory of Dad is different. It's a scene from my formative years in Lincoln, Nebraska. It is a Saturday in the dead of winter, and the junior faculty have convened around our dinner table on a snowy night to discuss politics and also to debate the merits, I imagine, of the latest short story by J.D. Salinger, and also to drink too many martinis. This I remember quite vividly, while watching the Sid Caesar show on television. I am old enough to be allowed to pick an olive or two off a pickled toothpick. It's getting late and I'm in bed, and in the distance I can hear my father and his friends roaring with laughter, and his laugh is infectious, one kind of barbaric yap, a roar of raucous merriment that filled a six-year-old with wonder at the sheer weirdness of the human scene, and also filled him with the desire someday to join his dad at a dinner table where he might join in the conversation too, and be able to discuss politics and the common culture, and to drink martinis, and to roar wildly, warming up even a long, cold, wintry night. "In the beginning is my end," wrote T.S. Eliot, and through the profound impression left by his intellect, his integrity, and that laugh, Dad will forever be a part of me and of my beginning.
I have just a few things I'd like to say about Dad. One of my earliest memories is of driving from Nebraska to Oklahoma for Thanksgiving with Dad's family. Grandma and Grandpa lived way out in the country on a dirt road with a few houses along one side and flat fields stretching out as far as you could see. I remember the gigantic sunflowers lining the ditches of the roads out there. When the car crossed the state line into Oklahoma, Dad would announce the fact, and then we'd competed over who would see the first oil rig. To this day, I feel a strong nostalgia at the sight of those strange creature-like machines, like they are distant relatives of mine. I knew Grandpa worked for the oil companies. To me, as a child, Dad's Oklahoma origin seemed so exotic. He was born on Cactus Hill, a place you cannot find on a map. He grew up poor in the Depression, in the Dust Bowl. There were stories about a time when they lived as squatters in an abandoned shack. When I first heard these stories, I was growing up in a new subdivision of Lincoln, Nebraska, a big city compared to where Dad's folks lived. In high school, living in the much bigger city of Chicago, I had to write a biographical essay about someone, so I picked Dad. I asked him to tell me about his life when he was my age, 13 years old at the time. He talked about he and his friends, all poor country kids, would entertain themselves. Climbing up to swim in a water tower was one of their pastimes. Shooting marbles was another. It all seemed so thrillingly quaint and old-timey. The only hint of the difficulties of life back then was Dad's story about the pecans. That year, when he was 13, the only way his family could afford to buy Christmas presents was to shell pecans. They bought bags of unshelled pecans, shelled them, and sold them back for a slight profit. This story in particular impressed me. At the time, I think I was mainly relieved that I myself did not have to shell pecans in order to get a little spending money. Dad remained always connected to his Oklahoma roots, no matter how lofty his academic career became. His love of travel seemed always to contain a bit of the country boy's sense of curiosity and adventure. His career afforded him many travel opportunities, but beyond that, he never seemed terribly interested in the other trappings of academic achievement. When we traveled through Europe in 1959, after spending the academic year in Naples, Dad would sing me and Jimmy awake each morning. "Oh, what a beautiful morning," and "Everything's up to date in Kansas City" were popular, as were "Three Little Fitties" and "Little Sir Echo." He would be very cheerful and silly, coaxing us grumpy and groaning to get up. For some reason, this custom only existed while we were traveling abroad. I remember Dad's booming laugh that would float up from the parties he and Mom hosted over the years, big and wholehearted with loud, wheezing in-breaths. I also remember Dad's special way of clearing his throat, which was a kind of loud harumph. It was how I knew he was in the audience during my excruciating performances in the high school orchestra. I remember a time after Jim and I had left home and were living on opposite coasts when we would receive at Christmas time large shipments of big, high-quality shelled pecans. I thought about the time when he had to shell pecans to make a little money and how much fun it must have been to lavish all those pecans on us. After Mom died, Dad took up baking. He learned how to make all kinds of breads, including baguettes, popovers, Irish soda bread, cornbread. He started making the chocolate cake he used to brag about when we were younger, that he knew how to make the best chocolate cake, but he'd never made it for us, that was the joke, until after Mom died. Dad made my wedding cake, 3 tiers of his special chocolate cake. I'd moved back to Chicago when I married, after years of being away. It was a gift to be living so close to him during these last 20 plus years, and it was especially a gift that he was there when my marriage and my life came apart and I desperately needed help. He helped me. He would say to me, "You are my daughter, and I want to help you." That simple, that unconditional. During the difficult years of his decline, memory waning, he still usually had for me a big smile of recognition. He would always ask about my children, were we all doing okay, with some gesture in his voice about the rough times he'd helped us get through. He took to talking like an Okie at times, especially when making jokes. His sense of humor never left him. He liked watching Grapes of Wrath and Oklahoma. He liked riding in the car and seeing the lake and the city. And during our drives together, looking at the sights of Chicago, listening to Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, he would turn to look at me with a fierce expression of love and pride and say, "You are my daughter." It felt very good.
Good afternoon. My name's Elaine Hadley. I'm the current chair of the English department at the University of Chicago, and I would just ever so briefly like to welcome all the friends, family, colleagues of James E. Miller to his wonderful memorial service today. I did not know Jim well at all, but I have had a wonderful time getting to know Kathleen in the intervening weeks as we've worked toward this memorial service. And as the days have approached, I've had any number of conversations with people who've come up to me remembering ways in which Jim helped his own graduate students, ways in which he furthered the ends of American literature in the secondary and high schools of our country. And listening to his children, it has painted this wonderful picture of him, and I'm sure I'm going to be hearing a lot more about it today. So I would like at this point to hand the podium over to my dear colleague, Janelle Mueller, the William Rainey Harper Distinguished Service Professor at the University of Chicago.
Thank you, Elaine. Let me echo her. Good afternoon, and let me extend a second welcome to this event in honor and in memory of Jim Miller. I have been so very grateful to Kathleen for offering me a place in this rich program, and specifically one that follows Elaine Hadley, the present chair of the English department, as you've just heard. You'll come to see why I stress Elaine's present position. Kathleen has given me an optimal opportunity to salute Jim Miller in the role in which I knew him best, that of a two-time chair of the English department. Jim Miller's chairship of the English department was simply transformative. He took over the leadership of a stratified, hierarchical cohort of colleagues. Senior faculty set the tone and course of the department, while younger faculty stayed mostly on the sidelines of discussion and action. Jim Miller rapidly shifted those coordinates. He engaged with all of us, senior or junior, in his open, genial manner. He listened sensitively and at length to previously muted voices, and he brought previously sidelined members into active participation in departmental affairs. I remember being astonished to find Jim Chandler and myself on the policy committee, an unimaginable development before Jim Miller became chair. Ever a man who integrated his academic pursuits with his living of life, as we've just heard from his son in such a rich way, As chair of the English department, Jim Miller enacted a Walt Whitman-esque embrace of us all as camarados, as equals. More specifically, the transformation of the department that Jim Miller wrought under his influence and his egalitarian treatment of his colleagues opened places for women and encouraged their participation in what had largely been a gentleman's club. When Jim became chair, the department had three women, Beth Helsinger, Christina Van Nalken, and myself. During his two terms, offers were extended to two senior women and at least four junior women were hired, the most notable of these, Lauren Berlant. I will close this salute to Jim Miller's chairship and its effects by venturing to offer a specific case in point. When Jim's second term was ending, Jay Schleusner and Jim Chandler, two junior faculty, please note, served as the ear committee to hear out the department's wishes regarding a successor. Jim and Jay eventually reported to another colleague, the then Dean of Humanities, Stuart Tave, that Janelle Mueller was the department's choice as next chair. There was quite a bit of incredulity all around, including a fair amount from me, but I did follow him. What an act to follow. I rest my case regarding the exceptional human being and colleague who was Jim Miller and his transformative impact on the English department. Here's to his continuing memory, kept alive by our deep respect and affection. Now, I've also been asked to outline the ceremonies here. The program, beautifully explicit, as everything that Kathleen has contrived, it is going to be followed exactly, with the exception of within the tribute section, which follows our colleagues here. John Hagert is unable to be with us today. He's had a medical crisis. And so when Don Peace finishes speaking, David Kiebrick will be the next speaker. All right, and I turn matters over to Tony Yu.
Thank you, Janelle. In the spring quarter of 1964, ending my first year of doctoral studies at the University of Chicago, I enrolled in Jim Miller's graduate course on Faulkner that in 10 weeks covered some short stories and most of the major novels. The next year, I also registered for his similar course on Hemingway and Fitzgerald. Eventually auditing his two more courses on Melville and American poetry would solidify my knowledge and appreciation of Jim as a master teacher, whose practice of his vocation would become one enduring model in my teaching career. Since I received both my final degree and my first full-time appointment at this university from the Divinity School, some of today's audience may wonder why I opted for classes in English. The reason lies in my choice of studying religion and literature, a small interdisciplinary program pioneered by some faculty of the Divinity School and in which I also taught for 40 years. In the 60s, the requirement for any doctoral student in this area would be at least 9 graduate courses for credit in English or another literary department. Contact with Jim was not limited just to my years of coursework, because even prior to my enrollment on campus, as I was told, Jim was already serving with Wayne Booth as associate members of the Divinity School faculty in religion and literature. That relationship thus provided continuous opportunity both before and after my few classes with him ended to witness at close range in colloquia, examinations, and informal conversations, Jim's superlative virtues as a teacher and scholar. He was patient and precise in lectures and discussions, meticulous in both speech and comment to help his audience grasp what he would consider the noteworthy details of the text, and he was always alert to new knowledge or unanticipated ways of construing meaning advanced by his students and other authorities. His close reading of a work or passage, when called for, could outshine any of the new critics, but he did not hesitate to use a wide range of historical materials to contextualize or strengthen a particular argument of his own. His first book on T.S. Eliot of 1977, in fact, made prescient and percipient use of certain idioms and insights of queer theory before that mode of criticism was invented. But the book was savaged by reviewers on both sides of the Atlantic. His much fuller and erudite account of T.S. Eliot, The Making of an American Poet, appearing finally in 2005 and dedicated to Kathleen Farley, exorcised the demons of hostile critics and confirmed his stature as a acclaimed literary historian and critical biographer. In 1978, I was being reviewed for promotion at the university. Newly elected as chair of English at the time, Jim visited my office one day and told me that he had made an appointment to take me to see the Divinity School dean. As we were seated in the dean's office, I was properly apprehensive, for I had no idea whatever why we were there. Then Jim spoke firmly but quietly. "As I told you, Joe, over the phone, I had cleared with my department and received permission from my dean to invite Tony Yu to join English as a faculty member. The provost has been informed. Please tell Tony to accept our invitation." To relieve my utter surprise and inability to reply coherently to this disclosure, the dean told me to consider the kind offer overnight. My eventual acceptance of this honor would lead to acquaintance with many new colleagues in English and to even more welcome contact with Jim and his wife over the remaining decades. For several times in his home over some of the best culinary treats, and of course, those wonderful martinis, my wife had tasted and I had tasted in Hyde Park. That contact necessarily lessened as we both advanced in years, and the last one away from his home was one nearing my own retirement. It became just as much a surprise as Jim's activity had been in that dean's office. 2 weeks before the end of spring quarter in 2005, another presiding dean of the Divinity School had arranged that the weekly Wednesday luncheon for faculty, staff, and students, long a Swift Hall tradition, be used for current students and a few returning alums to celebrate informally my end of service. To my astonishment, Jim, who by then was already 85 and suffered from considerable difficulty in walking, appeared at the door of our commons room and told me, "I wanted some lunch with you," with a resonant chuckle. After the meal and the first student's words, Jim steadied himself on the table and my shoulder to stand up and walk to the podium with a tremorous declaration. "I also want to offer a word of testimony about my friend, Tony Yu." As I recall this particular event presently, what moves me beyond description is not just the content of his remarks. It is the magnanimity of the act itself that I would cherish for the rest of my life. Although I reached the US some 55 years ago to enter college and eventually to become a naturalized citizen, I cannot claim to be wholly free of lingering deference to Chinese cultural constraints in which I was reared. Whereas the reverse is always held to be one's duty, a teacher is not obliged to praise or commend a student openly. According to an adage that the Chinese love to speak, quote, "even now, once a teacher, always a father. And a father is not supposed to lord a child in public. Whether Jim, who had been to China twice to teach and to participate in a conference, was aware of his act's implication is of no concern to me. One glance, however, at a preface like that in his The American Quest for a Supreme Fiction, published in 1979, would reveal that the populous company he thanked were all his former and current students. His tribute to them as colleagues and intellectual partners who helped him write his book was similar to the spontaneous testimony at my retirement luncheon, a gesture worthy of his beloved Walt Whitman by continuing a democratic impulse that repudiates the specious difference of hierarchy. To commemorate one of the most distinguished Americanists in the second half of the 20th century, I hope you would allow me to add a brief word about Jim's relations to another Chinese friend and colleague. Because that person is also no longer with us, I feel compelled to testify on her behalf about how for many years she was a beneficiary of Jim's unswerving support and assistance in her scholarship. Lucy Chen, née Zhao Luo Rui, was a Chinese national who received a doctorate from our English department in 1948, 1 year before Jim received his. Though contemporaries, they did not know each other while in grad school, and Jim did not meet Lucy until 1981 in Chicago. Soon after the success of the Communist Revolution in 1949, Lucy felt called to return to serve the new China. A Chinese government commission organized in 1955 to select certain foreign literary works for translation into Chinese authorized her in 1962 to do a complete translation of Whitman's Leaves of Grass. Though she wrote her dissertation on Henry James, Lucy accepted the appointment, and this task developed into the single consuming passion of her scholarly life. Lucy's husband, Chen Mengjia, was one of the most respected historians of China's antiquity, but he committed suicide during the height of the Cultural Revolution, 1966 to 76, after suffering unspeakable atrocities from the rampaging Red Guards perpetrated on their persons, their belongings, and their residence in Beijing. Although Chairman Mao Zedong's death in 1976 marked that country's gradual return to social stability and less despotic rule, Lucy told me during my one brief and only return visit to China in 1986 as an adult, that her status as a professor of English at Beijing University was never fully restored. Sharing the fear of many intellectuals at the time that another social catastrophe might descend at any moment, Lucy showed me where she had hidden all her most treasured Western books, papers, correspondence, and the ongoing translation manuscript for Whitman's epic, the deathbed edition of Leaves of Grass. At the front courtyard of the old-style Peking house left to her by her husband, a tiny one-room edifice stands before and separate from the main hall. When Lucy invited me to look inside, I found upon entrance the entire small space jammed with books and papers from floor to ceiling, and that was how she managed to save a good portion of her most important intellectual property from wanton destruction and confiscation. The Red Guards and other zealots, Lucy said with a wan smile, thought it beneath their dignity to poke their noses into a privy. It was my good fortune that in late May of 1986, Lucy had just completed the first draft of her entire Whitman project, and she showed me all 1,700 pages of the handwritten manuscript that she guarded several times literally with her life. A huge percentage of those books and papers I glimpsed in the little building were gifts generously purchased by personal funds and faithfully sent during these 3 decades by Jim Miller and by Gwen Cope, another devoted friend of Lucy's and late professor of English at Chicago. When mail was not cut off, Jim was assisting constantly in needed research and the interpretation of the poems, lines, or passages. Lucy's 2-volume book, published in 1991 as the first complete translation of this American masterpiece by a single person, thus also records abundantly the lasting impact of Jim's scholarship and humanity. Putting both person and publication at risk in the world's most populous state of relentless censorship, the book's postface courageously declares what the translator found to be most attractive in this founding master of American verse: a dedicated determination to craft a new demotic style of poetic language, an unshakable faith in democracy and pluralistic spirituality, and an irrepressible affirmation of sensuality and the wholesomeness of both hetero and gay lesbian sex. Other colleagues participating in today's service, like Professors David Kubrick and Kenneth Price, I realize, also have much to tell about Jim's Chinese connection. My own experience of Jim as a former teacher, friend, and colleague persuades me that he too has written the legacy of his life and work in colossal ciphers. Thank you.
I first met Jim Miller in 1970. At the time, I had recently joined the headquarters staff of the National Council of Teachers of English, NCTE, in Urbana, Illinois, and attended meetings of the executive committee that year, during which Jim was president of the council. When the executive committee held one of its annual meetings in Urbana, my wife, Joanne, hosted the group at a reception at our home and thereby first became acquainted with Jim. In 1972, Joanne took advantage of that acquaintanceship. Our younger son, Sean, then 2 years old, was operated on in Chicago for a congenital birth defect. Upon arrival in the city, Joanne learned from hospital officials that she was mistaken in believing she would be able to spend the night in the hospital following Sean's operation. Not knowing anything about accommodations in Chicago, she phoned her only known resource, the Millers. Jim and Barbara immediately assured her that she should stay with them, and she did. Thus began a series of exchange visits over the years. En route to visit Jim's brother and sister in Houston, Jim and Barbara, later Jim and Kathleen, lay over with the Farrells in Austin, Texas, where I had taken a position with the university, and the Farrells, in turn, took advantage of the Millers' gracious offering of room and board when they visited the latter's home grounds. During those exchanges, I learned a good deal about Jim's background, some of which has already been mentioned, of his youth in Oklahoma during years of the Great Depression and Dust Bowl, of his love of folk songs from that era, of the periods having shaped his political beliefs as a liberal Democrat, of his loyalty to the University of Oklahoma, from which he had graduated, from which he had received his BA degree, and from which he had graduated Phi Beta Kappa, the latter a fact I learned from others, not from Jim, of his having served as an Army cryptographer during World War II, and of his having been sworn to such secrecy that long after codes had been publicly released after the war, he still had difficulty speaking about his time in the service, of his having written at this university under the direction of Professor Walter Blair, the first dissertation in America on the work of F. Scott Fitzgerald, a distinction which Jim took understandable pride. I also learned that though Jim wasn't much for telling jokes himself, he readily greeted my ribald stories with robust laughter, laughter that reverberates in memory's ear. From approximately the mid-1970s until 1991, Jim and I worked together on Scott Forstman's America Reads series of high school anthologies of literature, anthologies that were being read in about one-fourth of the nation's secondary classrooms and were thereby helping influence the literary taste of hundreds of thousands of secondary students. Working as co-editors, authors on the series, were not only professors of English and English education, but also highly capable high school teachers of English. Despite his being the most eminent contributor to the series, never was Jim condescending to colleagues, for that matter, to anyone I ever saw him meet. Always it was, "Hi, I'm Jim Miller," not Professor James E. Miller Jr., not Dr. James Miller, just plain, unpretentious Jim. In 1997, National Textbook Company published a college freshman reader that Jim and I had co-edited, one on which we had spent over 2 years culling selections, dividing responsibilities, and composing editorial material. Titled The Perceptive Eye, the first person singular nominative pronoun, a pun on the pronoun and on the organ of sight, the book contained first-person excerpts from autobiographies, memoirs, diaries, essays, and letters. We believed that undergirding every piece of writing is personal choice, an overt or covert I that an outsider can always ask, in a universe of discourse, why are you writing about this rather than something else? Assignments that followed selections in the reader tried to move students gradually from writing in the first person about their own experiences to composing in the third person. Unfortunately, despite the book's transparent excellence, it disappeared quickly into a publishing sump hole, there to remain unread, unappreciated, and alas, unsold. Jim believed, as do I, that literature is central to English studies, and that central to the teaching of literature is education of the imagination. I will close with two brief quotations from Northrop Frye that I recently read in Writer's Almanac, words about the importance of both literature and the imagination, words with which Jim would surely concur. There are two halves to literary experience. Imagination gives us both a better and worse world than the one we usually live in and demands that we keep looking steadily at both. The fundamental job of the imagination in ordinary life is to produce out of the society we have to live in a vision of the society we want to live in. As I believe Jim did and would have us continue to do, let us work to fulfill that vision.
I'm Don Pease, and I'm deeply honored to have been asked to a memorial service to commemorate the life of a man who, for me, continues to exemplify both the responsibility and the ideals of the teacher. Jim Miller was born on the same day which he died. His beginning was his end, an image of eternity that his favorite poet, T.S. Eliot, could not have imagined associated with a better man. Jim Miller came out of the Great Depression. But the war, which was the experience to which he came to terms with the deep loss that constituted the heart that grew out of the losses of the Depression, resulted in his, along with the other great soldier critics who came into the United States after the war, Henry Nash Smith, Robert Penn Warren, Alfred Kazin. Dedication to the construction of what was then called the Myth Symbol School of American Literary Studies. The Myth Symbol School was actually a name for the ideal of America, soldiers who had experienced the deep trauma of war, which for them was the shadow memory of the depression that preceded the war, was a means whereby they created the America they wanted to fight in the name of, so they could return to a home that would enable them to let go of the memories both of the war and of the experiences that preceded it. I know that all of the works Jim Miller wrote, from Start with the Sun to the work on T.S. Eliot, which recalled him to his depression, T.S. Eliot's personal wasteland, were works that exemplified for James E. Miller, Jr. He kept that junior throughout the entirety of his 90 years of life, although for many of us, he was the father we wished we had, was a figure who through his imagination had produced a quest for an itinerary in life that would justify his image of America. When I was preparing my remarks for this memorial service, I went through my mementos for Jim. Among his many endearing qualities was his wish to send each year a Christmas greeting that was prepared by his own hand, in which he wrote down the itinerary of the year. This is 1994, highlighted August 31, Chicago, Chicago, welcomed home with fanfare by daughter Lurie, interim keeper of the house and books. When I came to Chicago in 1970, my experience was not the Depression, but the event 1968. And between 1968 and 1970, I wasn't involved in a quest for a supreme fiction. I was in an itinerary of serial losses. My first experience with James E. Miller was reading The Inverted Mystical Experience of Song of Myself under the guidance of a teacher that was banned in 48 states at the time. I'm afraid to mention that substance in these halls. But James E. Miller, Jr. was a figure who welcomed me to a different experience of what he called the cosmic quest. My first class with Jim Miller was on the lyric epic, and in it he discussed the relationship between Hart Crane's The Bridge and Walt Whitman's Crossing Brooklyn Ferry, and he said this: if you want to understand eternity, you don't understand eternity as a place, and you don't understand eternity as a thought, and you don't understand eternity as a mood or an emotion. It's what's in between your thoughts that's not yet been bridged, for which you have no itinerary. When I graduated University of Chicago in 1973, I asked Jim Miller to give me some advice on how to teach my first class at Dartmouth College, and I expected this to be a moment of instructive initiation. He said, "Sit down, Don. I'll give you the same advice my dissertation director, Raven McDavid, gave me when I was about to go to the University of Nebraska." I thought this would be a moment of profound instruction. He said, "Don, make sure you don't wear the same necktie two classes in a row because your class will notice and they'll think the lesser of it. Jim Miller kept the junior and wrote guides because he was a figure who always stood at a threshold to welcome you into a home. My fondest recollections, Jim Miller, were greetings at his door, 5536 Blackstone, in which he would stand along with a server and lead you to the dining room and then go to the kitchen and serve you. The junior is a means of reminding all of us that as teachers, we're simultaneously students of the literature that reminds us of what's called us into teaching, and we're servants of the servant, the word that remembers us out of a loss into a life. Critics who've read my work have said, you must be in deep rebellion against your teacher, because the new Americanists would appear to have not only deconstructed and dismantled, but destroyed the myth symbol school of American literary studies. But as Jim and I discussed on many occasions, the America he imagined in the myth symbol school and the America through which I was attached by means of my criticism was the same America. It was the America that you educate the imagination to inhabit. My last memory, the one that never dies, Jim Miller, was his meeting on 1973, my graduation day. My father at his door, a father with whom I had not spoken in 4 years because he didn't think I'd end up in the institution, University of Chicago, but lesser venerated ones. And when he met my father, was a corporate attorney with the opposite of this institution. I looked in their eyes and saw they shared the same experiences of the Depression and the war and the great hope for an America that has not yet risen in the West. When I last came to Chicago 11 years ago, Jim was not at my talk, and I felt that the department had shown great disrespect for the teacher I loved. This service in memorializing him recovers my relation to the old mother. Jim Miller still stands now at the door in a gesture of infinite hospitality, which is in between thoughts as a future that has not yet come.
My name's Dave Kiebrick, and I was a graduate student of Professor Miller's in the late 1960s and early 1970s. And Janelle, you talk about hard acts to follow. I feel like I'm following a lot of very good actors. I'd sort of like to just silently walk out the door. But actually, it's very good to be back at the University of Chicago and once again in the tasteful setting of Bond Chapel. I especially recall two earlier events here. The first, a moving religious service conducted by Reverend William Sloan Coffin and Dr. Benjamin Spock in the days of the Vietnam War. The second, the marriage of two English graduate student friends. But today's gathering is by far the most important for me. It's, of course, a sad and solemn time, but also, as we've seen, it's also a time where we're all joining together to celebrate the spirit of not only a distinguished scholar, but also a very dedicated and talented teacher, and of course, a thoroughly decent and generous and wonderful and lovable man. And I confess, I really find it very easy to eulogize Jim Miller. In fact, I've eulogized him every day of my professional career. I've always told my friends, my colleagues, I was just simply so lucky to have him as my teacher, my dissertation advisor, and friend. I want to speak primarily about him as a teacher and mentor, but I will make one point about him as a scholar. In thinking about how I would, in a sentence, characterize his approach to Walt Whitman, an area of scholarship that we shared, I guess I would define it as an informed openness to the distinctive and personal qualities of the poet's voice. And I think it worked very well. I think it made Professor Miller the best reader of Whitman's poetry to date. Turning to him as a teacher, here again I want to emphasize that openness to the voices of others. And that I think I'm following a theme that others have mentioned. And I still remember my first course with him. He was as nattily dressed as he is in that photo. And yes, I remember that he had a very good tie. It was a course on Emerson and Whitman and Dickinson. And it definitely wasn't a course on Professor Miller's views. He simply didn't foreground himself and his ideas in the classroom. Instead, he worked to disclose the voices of the writers we were studying. And I see this as a type of very welcome pedagogical humility. And extending this point, I would say, to pick up on another earlier theme, Professor Miller was, in every respect, the most unpretentious professor I ever had. He also showed a respectful openness to the voices of his students. Even when someone would make a rather off-the-wall observation about a writer, Professor Miller would respond with that kind of boyish chuckle of his and say something to the effect, "You know, I'd never thought of that," and then turn us in a more productive direction. And in directing my dissertation, he would pose questions and point to possible pitfalls. But I never felt one bit of pressure to read Walt Whitman as he did. In addition to this openness and unpretentiousness, another point I'd make about Professor Miller was his amazing productivity, not only in his scholarship, but in his teaching and advising as well. Procrastination is, I think, a minor vice among professors, or at least it's an affliction for me. Stacks of student papers and endless requests for letters of recommendation can easily be set aside. And I think it was even easier to do this back in the either bad old days or good old days before student evaluations. But as far as I could see, for Professor Miller, procrastination was simply an alien concept. I know I would submit my dissertation chapters and always within a few days, they would be returned with comments. The same was true for the many letters of recommendation I asked him to write. They always got written, and they always got written on time. And such sterling work habits can spoil a student. I recall once I put a thesis chapter in his mailbox while he was out of town. When he returned, I promptly, eager graduate student, stopped by his office to pick it up. Glancing upward at me from what he was doing at his desk, he voiced a little frustration. "You know, David, I just got back yesterday." But I would emphasize just a little frustration. For in his dealings with me, Professor Miller was always more than civil, he was also very supportive. I remember one day going into the English department to check on my financial support for the coming year, and I was surprised, in fact, deeply shocked, to learn it wasn't being extended. I then went to Professor Miller's office about another matter, but I also shared the bad news. He got up and left for about 5 minutes. Upon returning, he simply reported, "You still have your fellowship." You can see why I find it easy to eulogize him. I will conclude by drawing upon an image from Whitman. In Song of the Open Road, he projects this wonderful emblem of human history as the progression of souls throughout time along a great highway with no spatial or temporal bounds, a limitless pathway for traveling souls. I've had the very good fortune to travel a ways along this grand road of life with Professor Miller. He was truly a great traveling companion, and he enriched my life immeasurably. To have had the very good luck to have been a student of Jim Miller's, for that I will always be thankful. And I know many, many other students share this same profound appreciation of him. His life is truly a cause for respectful remembrance, praise, and celebration.
I'm Jan Keeson, and I want to thank you for inviting me to speak today. I received a note from Elaine while I was still in Missoula, Montana, about this, very tactfully asking us what we were going to talk on, and under the auspices of not wanting us to repeat ourselves, but also how long are we going to talk, and suggesting maybe we limit things to 5 minutes. So I looked down this list of people, I'm last, I have the shortest title, and I was tempted to write back and say, well, since I have the shortest title, I'm assuming I can have the longest speech. But we'll see how true that is. I don't think I've ever been at a memorial service where they sang Red River Valley before, but I think they should do more of it. It's one more thing that reminds me how much I love Jim and what kindred spirits we have. I teach a class on the American West where I require students to sing the Red River Valley as one of the requirements. I met Jim around 30 years ago when I was a student at the university. His class on Paul Hawthorne and Melville, subtitled The Marvelous Ambiguities, was the first class I took. I sat on the edge of my seat during most class periods, but when time came for dialogue, I was too shy to say much. And I found my first face-to-face meeting with him downright frightful. He had a bear trap brain, but his eyes were kind, and gradually I gained more confidence. He taught me how to read carefully, Chicago style. More important, he taught me how to tell the difference between a good book and a great book. He took me on a whaling voyage where the great floodgates of the wonder world swung open for me. He introduced me to one grand hooded phantom like a snow hill in the sea, and a captain who railed against the Calvinist God, demanding fair play in the universe, but knowing all the while that the path to his fixed purpose was laid with iron rails whereon his soul was grooved to run. On that voyage, Jim also taught me to pay close attention to minor characters like Dives, who live like a czar in an ice palace made of frozen sighs, and who, as presidents of the Temperance Society, only drank the tepid tears of orphans. He also taught me that it was better to sleep with a sober cannibal than a drunken Christian. He lives with me in memory and in writing and in the generosity of his spirit. Promising students are offered enviable awards from an endowment he's established, the Barbara Ann Miller Award, the most prestigious award on our campus. In my office, there's an entire shelf of well-thumbed scholarly works he's written, and I use the Heritage of American Literature a lot. The anthology he and Kathleen put together so beautifully. Whenever I read it, it's as though he's still speaking to me, still teaching me. I miss him a lot, but he lives on with great energy, like the buoy rising, like the life buoy rising up from the dirge-like main, always ready to rescue one more drifting orphan. He lives on through the redemptive nature of art and the grace he's made so real for all of us. Thank you.
At this point, we have an open mic, as they say. You are invited to share your memories. I think no holds barred in terms of precedent that's already been set here. So if anyone would care to speak, please come forward.
Thank you, Janelle. I'll introduce myself. I'm Bill Monroe. I'm a professor of English at University of Houston and Dean of the Honors College. Some of the remarks, some of the points I'll touch on briefly have already been touched on, but I think they bear repeating. One of the great joys embedded in the profession comes from those fulfilling and sustaining relationships between colleagues who are separated by a span of years and often many miles, making them like mothers and fathers to daughters and sons. Jim Miller was chair of the Department of English during the 5 years allotted to me to be at Chicago, a relatively brief period, but only the beginning of 35 years of benefit from his kindliness, affirmation, and generosity. Some of his giving came in the form of what we call productivity. Especially impressive, as you've heard, was his Harcourt Anthology of American Literature, which I was proud to use whenever I taught American Fiction 1 or 2 or the Survey. Rather like Dr. Johnson with his 1755 Dictionary of the English Language, Jim Miller was the equal of the passel of scholars required for the research, development, and production of the other comprehensive surveys, Norton, Longmans, Macmillan, Heath, Harper, and so on, with each of their many editors taking but a single period in writing a manageable number of notes and essays compared to the entire two-volume project that Jim completed with only the assistance of his beloved wife, Kathleen. His books on Whitman, Eliot, and absurd and absurd quests were also important, but of more significance to me as one of Jim's intellectual progeny was his affirmation of my more humble contributions. I'm thinking of Jim's involvement in the planning of our Common Ground NEH Teachers Institute and his extended stays in Houston, in July no less, and that was when it still rained in Texas, to serve as our scholar in residence, or the eloquent gift of a Whitman tie or a hand-decorated Dickinson poem to mark and celebrate a book publication or promotion. And always an open door for me, my friends and students, and even my sulky teenaged boys at 5536 Blackstone. Perhaps that captures these fatherly, perhaps what captures these fatherly gifts best is Jim's affirming and engaging laughter. That joyful sound of communion was a delightful part that stood for the whole. And in that sense, it is one thing about Jim that I will remember best and miss most. For it seemed to me that Jim's robust laughter said, "Very good. Well done. You are a careful reader, a good student. I am proud of you. Your effort pleases me. This is fun. Life is good." When Jim laughed at something you'd said, some comic juxtaposition or irony, it was more than an avuncular chuckle. From his exuberant laugh, you got the sense that for him, much of life and the world, however painful, was ultimately hilarious. If the context were ripe, a passing allusion to The Wasteland, arguably a sacred text for Jim, and not intentionally funny, could bring out that surprising burlesque laugh. Once a former student and I were having drinks with Jim and Kathleen when Jim brought out a New Yorker article on Eudora Welty and her story, A Worn Path. Welty's story tells the tale of Phoenix Jackson, a poor black woman who, near the end of her life, makes a poignant journey to Natchez to get medicine for her grandson, who had swallowed lye 2 years before. Jim admired the article's focus on Phoenix Jackson as the center of value in the story and a representative of simple charity and courage in the face of suffering. The student agreed, but pointed out that a crucial moment of the story occurs when a man out hunting with his dog drops a flashing nickel, and Granny, as the hunter condescendingly calls her, with a sly and stealthy movement, slips her fingers under the coin, quote, "with the grace and care they would have in lifting an egg from under a setting hen." Thus does crafty Phoenix Jackson fleece the smug white man. This contribution from the student brought forth that twinkling laugh of Jim's with its distinctive onomatopoetic syllable, an extended high-pitched sound like something you might hear in a bluegrass song, something that sounded and felt like glee. Jim was a maker of books, a maker of professors and educated persons, a maker of eggs and bacon in the morning, and a maker of glee, an affirming sweetness gifted to any and all who were lucky enough to be nearby.
How to do this. I represent the other side of the family. And I'm not an English major. Everybody out there an English major? Raise your hands. Yep, I knew it. And I'm not an academic. I'm sorry, don't take off 10 points before I get started. But Jim Miller, there's a whole nother side of Jim Miller I wanted to try to tell you about. I want to get outside the halls of academia for a second. I want to leave those behind. I want to leave teaching behind. I never met T.S. Eliot. I don't know who he is. But I do know a little bit about Jim Miller. And what I want to do, if the professors will allow me, is to tell you a short story. But it's a short story with where the grammar is not going to be very good, and I apologize for that up front. I am somewhat of the antichrist for English majors in terms of my academic background. Jim Miller had a sister, and he had a brother. One of the things I want you guys to understand is that he was a lot more than just academics. These people down here in these first two rows are fantastic. They're interesting, they're fantastic, they're achievers. There are more top 10 university degrees sitting here at the moment than anywhere else in America, I guarantee you. These guys are, they've done a fantastic job, their kids are great. I'm sitting here with these young people with PhDs from Caltech, and I'm just overwhelmed with how wonderful this entire family is. I'm the luckiest guy in this room, and that is a true statement. Because my cousin Charlotte, who was up here just a moment ago, and my cousin Jim, head of political science at the New School, if you don't notice it already, I don't look like them. Jim's sister was named Maxine. She was an English major, University of Oklahoma, drama major. She put on plays. Bill Miller, his brother, became an engineer at NASA, helped work on the first space shuttle. You guys probably didn't know that. This entire family is incredible. I was adopted into this family. So for me, being relegated to the second row over here is nirvana. It's a great place to be. I've spent my whole life with my cousins and with my uncle Jim. And I want to give you a little glimpse of what he was like outside of the classroom, outside of academia, who he was as just a caring person. Some of that's been talked about, but I didn't actually, my background wasn't the best. Let's put it that way. The details don't matter. And one of the things that Jim, my Uncle Jim, did for me is he actually would come to Houston, Texas over and over again on his way to South America, or Central America, actually. And he would stop, and his wife, Barbara, at the time, and would get me in a corner, and they would ask me questions. Not unlike what you were talking about earlier. They would say things like, what do you want to be when you grow up? What do you enjoy? Who are you, anyway? And I would sit there, it was blank look on my face, because nobody in my world asked questions like that. It just didn't happen in my life. When he would come to Houston, Texas, and I'm a kid, and I'm sitting against the wall watching these adults, there's a brother, a sister, there are his parents, my grandparents, Jim and Charlotte's grandparents in Houston, and I would watch these adults like kids do, right? And what was fascinating about this is that my Uncle Jim was special. Even in the eyes of the family members, he was a special guy. And when you're a kid growing up, and you kind of came where I came from, and the world that I lived in, watching what adults are like is how you decide what you're going to be when you grow up. It was for me. And so I watched this through elementary school and junior high school and high school. I would get conversations about who you're going to be, what you're going to be. And he became, and I think you guys mentioned it, but this is a real in-your-face story, he became what I wanted to be. And because admiration, but not because of the classroom, not because of teaching, not because of academics, admiration because he took the time to talk to me, where other adults did not. Now, if you guys have experienced that in your lives, you'll have some idea of what I'm saying. It may not speak to all of you, but it damn sure speaks to me. And I went to school longer than any professor in this place would like to admit their students did. I have like 240 graduate hours. It's embarrassing, actually. And when I graduated from Duke University with a PhD in mathematics and statistics, I live in North Carolina, and in North Carolina, being an academic, or particularly if you're a Duke person, it's kind of, you know, it's not like here in the halls of University of Chicago. At least you're nodding your head. I think you probably understand what I'm talking about. And this was a big deal. I was 35 years old. I had a brand new kid, and I wasn't getting a lot of feedback from people going, "You did great. What a wonderful thing you did. Man, you got out of Duke." It didn't happen. I told you I wasn't a very good speaker or English major, but it didn't happen. I was standing there one day in my kitchen in my brand new house and feeling very, very, very sorry for myself. And my wife brought in the mail, and it was, I have it at home. I should have brought it. I was going to bring it for you. I just got on the plane without it. And it was a letter from Jim Miller. And it was handwritten, and it says, "Dear Bill, I knew you would do it. I am, as you said earlier, I am proud of you." I know about you guys, but I don't have a lot of people telling me that they're proud of me all the time in my life. It just doesn't happen all that often. And so from an adopted kid from background like mine to have somebody of that stature, I could care less how many books he published. I could care less how great a teacher he was. I don't care. I care that he was proud of me. And it's something I will take with me the rest of my life. So when I come back to Chicago, it's an incredibly emotional thing for me. I look at my cousin Charlotte, I look at my cousin Jim, who I've known all my life, and it just does something in my stomach that can't be described. This is not about academics. This is about a man in a real touching way. The professors touched on it, but I'm giving it to you hard and fast and in your face. He was a great guy, and he really did take care of people. He was proud of me. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Hard acts to follow, but please, you have an opportunity to share some of your memories if you would like to do that. Bill Brown, another Bill. Thanks, Bill.
I'm Bill Brown. I currently teach in the English department, and I chaired the department around 2006, I think. And so this is back into the gloomy halls of academia, for which I apologize. But I think just have three anecdotes I want to share. And one is that I met Jim Miller when I first came here in 1989, which is, I think, the last year that he was here. He might have even been retired, but he was still, that was, okay, Kathleen says that was his last year. And I don't think he was teaching a lot, but he was on one search committee. I was on the same search committee. And so it struck me that my experience of Jim there was different from some other people's experiences. He was a bit of an ass, and I was a bit of an ass. And we just got into this incredible argument over the course of months, right? And it was so productive and so interesting and so educational for me to continue to disagree with this person who also disagreed with me. And the two of us, by the end of the year, would go have a drink and continue the argument that we kept having in just a way that I absolutely cherish. And so, he became, for me that year, such a model of how you can strongly disagree with somebody and continue to learn from them. Then I also remember one hilarious evening at Kathleen's and Jim's. Don Pease had come to give a talk, and Jim very nicely invited me over for dinner. And we just got rip-roaring drunk, or at least, I don't know whether, Kathleen, whether you did, but I know Don did, and I know I did, and I think Jim did. And what was sort of powerfully educational about that for me was we did a little bit of gossiping, but mostly we were sort of arguing about Hawthorne, right? And we were doing it while drinking, becoming very passionate about our opinions. But that, and you have to remember, this is my first year with an academic job, but that to me was such an exercise in the way in which you can have fun, be passionate, be in some sense outside the halls of academia, but continue doing what you long to do, and to do it in a really serious intellectual way. My only regret the next morning was I kept thinking, okay, now, what did Jim say? And then what did I say? What did Don say? I mean, I couldn't quite remember exactly the moves people were making in their arguments. And then finally, the first year that I was chair, I think it was 2006, we had just redone the English department. We had moved quarters, and so that year, for the beginning of the year party, we decided to hold it actually in our new quarters, in the Walker Museum. And Jim and Kathleen came, and Jim came, although on the feeble side, but very much in particular to present to me and to the department his last book, a book on the young Eliot, the last of dozens and dozens of books. And to me that really in some sense completed a circle, because what was remarkable about that was how his passion for this poetry of Eliot's continued to sustain him and to vitalize him in a way that he wasn't just thinking about Eliot, he wasn't just writing about Eliot, but he was publishing on Eliot, and he wanted to make sure that his colleagues in the English department were aware of that, were reading it, and continued to be important interlocutors for him. So I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Another voice to hear from. John.
Hi, I'm John Bryant, another English major. And I'm sorry, there is a life after English majors. I had the pleasure of knowing Jim since my undergraduate years. I was here as an undergraduate from 67 to 71. And went on to graduate school here at Chicago, primarily following the lead of Jim Miller. He was a tremendous mentor, and I think as people speak, you get a clear sense of the kind of gentle and quiet nature that he had that I think made him very, very welcoming and open. But the thought that comes to me most is someone said once that here that he didn't push his ideas. And I think there's a strategy to that. I think he would sit in class and he would wait, and he would do a kind of Quakerly sort of thing and just wait for people to fill the silence and open up. And I think that gives a tremendous amount of feeling for the individual. And I think I was hearing that in the presentation that our friend, the cousin of the family, was making. I came at a time when I distinctly remember seeing Anthony Yu's book saying, well, who the hell is that? And I remember being in a seminar with Jim, and in comes Donald Pease, a graduate student, and Jim would say, well, Don, what do you think? And he would bring in his students and his ideas. You find out more and more how quietly there is a kind of a growing circle of people who have been influenced by this person, primarily because he was so giving and also so supportive in these kinds of ways. A couple of years ago, or about 10 years ago, I published a book called The Fluid Text. And basically it's about how any literary text exists in multiple versions, because writers are always rewriting themselves, or publishers are always changing editions, or societies are always insisting on censoring. And you know, it was a nice book. And I was sort of was fascinated by revision. Well, a couple of years ago, I was looking back in my books and I pulled off Song of Myself, an edition that Jim Miller had done and that we had studied in college, and I had actually forgotten about it. And I opened it up and I saw all of my notes. In this edition that he prepared, he had put on the left-hand side of the page the first edition of Song of Myself, and then on the right-hand side of the page, the equivalent, but in the 1892 deathbed edition. And all the changes were visible there. And all of my marks in this book, meticulously, were driven by Jim Miller's view, and I think what, and his addition, and his influence. And it had struck me as a college student and as a graduate student here that this idea that I had emerged was in part his idea, a fulfillment of that kind of thing. And I think we all live in a kind of circle of ideas. And when we can identify an individual who becomes the kind of wellspring for that, it's a deeply moving moment. Because one thing that I learned from the University of Chicago and have always loved, and I have sent my daughters to this school at no small expense, is that there is a life of the mind, and that the life of the mind is everything. The mind is everything, and we must live it. And that was what Jim was like. He would never have the same idea twice. And I find that enormously inspirational. Thanks.
Hi. Like my cousin Bill said, I basically know nothing about my grandfather as a scholar. I knew him as Grandpa. People would come up to me and talk to me about his books and whatnot, and it went over my head. I knew him as the guy who came to my soccer games, and I'm pretty sure I knew nothing about what was happening, but he cheered like he did. And when he would ask me about school or something, he would listen to me talk about math and social studies and anything. He didn't care that I wasn't talking about what I was reading or writing. He just cared that I was talking to him. That's what mattered. I do have a love for writing, which I think I got from him. But in my mind, he wasn't this great professor. He was this great grandfather, which I cherish to this day. At my bat mitzvah, I didn't know, but when they were giving speeches and whatnot, my grandfather stood up. And at that time, he was somewhat feeble. And he read a poem by Emily Dickinson that at the time didn't seem like much, but now it means everything to me. And as the years progressed and his condition worsened, he would say this, a few lines from it every once in a while. And it's something I always remember about him and cherish. So I'm going to read it to you. I'm nobody. Who are you? Are you nobody too? Then there's a pair of us? Don't tell. They'll advertise, you know. How dreary to be somebody. How public, like a frog. To tell one's name, the livelong June, to an admiring bog.
Song of Myself, Section 6. A child said, "What is the grass?" Fetching it to me with full hands, how could I answer the child? I do not know what it is any more than he. I guess it must be a flag of my disposition, out of hopeful green stuff woven. Or I guess it is the handkerchief of the Lord, a scented gift and remembrancer designedly dropped, bearing the owner's name some way in the corners, that we may see and remark and say, whose?
Or I guess the grass is itself a child, the produced babe of the vegetation. Or I guess it is a uniform hieroglyphic, and it means sprouting alike in broad zones and narrow zones, growing among black folks as among white, Canuck, Tuckahoe, Congressman, Cuff, I give them the same, I receive them the same. And now it seems to me the beautiful uncut hair of graves. Tenderly will I use you, curling grass. It may be you transpire from the breasts of young men. It may be if I had known them, I would have loved them. It may be you are from old people or from offspring taken too soon of their mother's laps, and here you are, the mother's laps.
This grass is very dark to be from the white heads of old mothers, darker than the colorless beards of old men, dark to come from under the faint red roofs of mouths. Oh, I perceive, after all so many uttering tongues, and I perceive they do not come from the red roofs of mouths for nothing. I wish I could translate the hints about the dead young men and women, and the hints about old men and mothers, and the offspring taken soon out of their laps.
What do you think has become of the young and old men? And what do you think has become of the women and children? They are alive and well somewhere. The smallest sprout shows there is really no death. And if ever there was, it led forward life and does not wait at the end to arrest it and cease the moment life appeared. All goes onward and outward. Nothing collapses. And to die is different from what anyone supposed, and luckier.
Before we listen to a composition that my son Michael, who you just heard reading, has composed and dedicated to my father, I thought it might be welcome to hear a few words from the man himself.
I know it's worthwhile. I know it from my own experience with literature. I know what literature did for me and does for me. And so nobody can convince me that literature has nothing to do with my life.
Thank you. took my breath away, Michael. It was so beautiful, and you chose the lines yourself, and it's incredibly beautiful, wasn't it? Well, how to choose a poem to read for this occasion, when the one I always turn to for advice is gone. And then, as I read the last paragraph of his last book on Whitman, there he was, helping me choose. He wrote, "To conclude this latest journey of mine through the poems of Leaves of Grass, I turn to one of my favorites, the title poem of Goodbye, My Fancy. The closing lines of this poem, addressed intimately to the poet's fancy, abruptly change direction. He suddenly affirms his newfound belief that he and his fancy will remain one, even in death. The passage may stand by itself, as I think Whitman would have liked, to close this book. Who knows, dear reader, for all the distance, he may be looking at us now. Long have we lived, joyed, caressed together, delightful. Now separation. Goodbye, my fancy. Yet let me not be too hasty. Long indeed have we lived, slept, filtered, become really blended into one. Then if we die together. Yes, we'll remain one. If we go anywhere, we'll go together to meet what happens. Maybe we'll be better off and blither and learn something. Maybe it is yourself now really ushering me to the true songs. Who knows? Maybe it is you, the mortal knob, really undoing, turning. So now, finally, goodbye and hail my fancy." I want to thank you all for coming, for all the speakers, the wonderful way in which you made Jim come alive, and of course he'll never die for those of us who loved him. And so I want you to come to the house now and continue the celebration.
Sweeping down the plain, and the waving wheat can sure smell sweet when the wind comes right behind the rain.